Let's just jump right in. Proverbs 29:18. Where there is no vision, the people perish. Mic drop. You know. Yeah. How many mics do we have? Yeah, because that's just that statement, where there is no vision, the people perish. Several hundred years ago, and it was several hundred years ago, a shipload of travelers landed on the northeast coast of America. And if you've read your history books, I'm summing all this up for you. But they landed on the northeast shores of America, the coast. And the first year, this group of travelers, the first year, they established a town site. I mean, they were real industrious and got, let's make a town. And then the next year, they elected a town government. Got a town, elected a government. The third year, the town government planned on building a road 5 miles westward into the wilderness. That's the third year. In the fourth year, the people tried to impeach their town government because they thought it was a waste of public funds to build a road 5 miles out into the wilderness. Now, and the reason I bring this up, because if you get the big picture, they were saying, well, who needs to go there? You know, who needed to go there anyway? Here were people, these are our ancestors, by the way. Here were people who had the vision to see a thousand miles, you know, across the ocean. They had the vision to see it. They had the vision to get in the boat and go through all the struggles they went through just to travel over all these great hardships to get here. And in just a few short years, 4 short years, they were not able to see even 5 miles out. Isn't that amazing? They couldn't even see 5 miles out. They had lost their pioneering vision. They got used to the way things were. Wow, wow. As Christians, especially today in our culture, as Christians with a clear vision of what we can become in Christ, there is no ocean of difficulty that is ever too great. And I hope we remember that on a daily basis, because we're faced with a lot of, opportunities for growth. We don't call them that when we're faced with them. We have a few other names we call them, but that's what they are. And so there's no ocean too great for us. But without a clear vision, then, we can rarely move on beyond our current boundaries. Without a clear vision, we're not going to go 5 miles out into the wilderness. We're going to stay right where we are and try to impeach our own self-government. Because we can't see any further than where we are. Where there is no vision, the people perish. If we fail to have vision, then we become like people in the illustration I opened with, and we lose that pioneering spirit. I love the pioneering spirit, where you're always willing to do whatever it takes to get it done, and you even discover new things in the middle of doing things you're already familiar with. It's so important that each of us have a vision for what God wants us to do. One of the biggest questions and most consistent questions I get as a pastor, as a counselor, as a chaplain is, well, what does God want me to do? What is God's will for my life? Now, in the 60s, we called that finding ourselves. I need to find myself. Are you? Well, you know, you go on these adventures and you really never find yourself because you're looking outside and you don't realize you're right here. You're looking out here. And so that's the biggest question I get is, what does God want me to do? And yes, we have to have a corporate vision. That is very, very important. Absolutely. But each of us have to understand ourselves as being blessed individuals. And you are, whether you realize it or not. We talk about this all the time, and I have to repeat it. I'm not talking about materialism. I'm not talking about that. That may or may not come. That big deal. You know, I'm talking about we are blessed. Each of us are. We're blessed individuals. Just to be called children of God is such a privilege that we lose sight of that sometimes. But we are blessed individuals with personal visions that come together to make up a much greater vision. Now, if you don't have a personal vision, that's what you need to pursue. That's what you need to get on your, literally, get on your knees to pursue if you don't know what God wants you to do. If you're just kind of floating along nonchalant, you don't have a clue, you need to get a clue. Because that's so important in your life to know, I'm doing what God wants me to do. There's no greater accomplishment than that. I know I'm doing what God wants me to do. God has a purpose and a plan for each Christian, meaning each individual, because each individual is the church. That's how that works. Yeah, and we know, we've talked about this many, many times. We are the church. We're the temple. This is just a building we gather in. I know we call it a church, but it's actually a building for the church. Each of us is the church. So we have to have our own vision so that we can, 2 Corinthians 6:16 is the reference for that. And we need to be devoted individually to accomplishing God's purpose and plan for ourselves in order to facilitate the accomplishment of a corporate vision, or better said, the vision of the entire body of Christ. Because if each person knows they're doing what God wants them to do, then when we come together collectively, we're going to do what God wants us to do. How's that go? We say that a lot, asking God to bless what we're doing. Let's just do what God's blessing rather than trying to get him to bless what we want to do. Does that make sense to you? This has become so vital due to the fact, my perception is that the average fellowship of believers in our country right now is just like a football game. You have 22 players in desperate need of a rest and 50,000 people watching in desperate need of exercise. It's like, what? You know, that's our American church culture right now. You got some people active, but man, they need a rest. And all the people in the stands are just, we're just eating popcorn and drinking sodas and watching everybody play the game. We need to get in the game. And I hope you don't take that. Well, you know, if you choose to take offense to that, give me a call. All right. So as we jump into this, we have to understand what is vision. Let's try to define that so that when I say vision, what am I talking about? Vision is the ability to see, or awareness. And if you go to the dictionary, there's some really good descriptions of that. Webster talks about the faculty of sight, unusual foresight, a mental image produced by your imagination. See, I know a lot of Christians who have just thrown their imagination out the window. Don't do that. Sometimes that's the best way God can get to you, is through your imagination, to get you to think of certain things, and all of a sudden you pinpoint something. So don't do that, because vision is produced by your imagination, the experience of the supernatural as if with eyes. Vision, according to John Maxwell, is awareness, or the ability to see, an attitude. It is the faith to believe, and it also includes action, faith to believe and the courage to actually do. George Barna, you know, they do all these surveys. He says that vision for ministry is a reflection of what God wants to accomplish through us to build his kingdom. And that applies very specifically to us, I really do believe. In our opening scripture, where there is no vision, the people perish. Vision here is the Hebrew word, which means divine revelation or direction and insight from God, where you know you're being prodded and directed by someone far greater and more insightful than you can ever be. So if you take all these definitions together, as I like to do, and you read them, place them in Proverbs 29:18, here's how it reads. Where there is no vision, where there is no awareness, where there is no divine revelation, direction, or insight from God, where there is no faith to believe in supernaturally unusual foresight and act upon it, where there is no sight beyond what our eyes are looking at, we the people perish. Without seeing what God sees, people are going to perish. The Word of God makes it very clear that when we, his people, when we do not get a fresh vision from him because we fail to seek him concerning what he wants to do through us, then countless people around us do not hear what God is offering to them through us. And I'm reminded, and I hope you are too, this is a partnership. We always want to point our finger at God, but we fail to work with God and let Him work through us. And that's how He's chosen to do it. That's why He sent His Son, to reconnect us to Him so that He could work in us, with us, and through us. So, if you know, why doesn't God? It should be, well, why doesn't Jerry? Why doesn't Sam? Why doesn't Lisa? You know, and we're faced with that every day too. Why does God allow? Well, why do you allow? Why do we allow? So God wants to work in us and through us, and without a vision, that's not going to happen. We have to keep our focus on heavenly matters. And I know the challenge with that on a day-to-day basis can be quite intense, because you got all this coming at you, you know, and you just wonder, well, how can I be heavenly minded in the middle of this, you know, in the middle of that? Well, you can be. You really can, as our brother said a long time ago, practice the presence of God in anything. In anything. You really can. It's a discipline, but you can do it. You have to keep your focus on eternal things and what God desires to do through you. You think you're doing a menial task, but that menial task is a tool to use you for God's purposes. We all know exactly what happens when we don't allow God to use us, when we don't allow Him to work through us. If there's anything we can be sure of today, I think it is this. God calls His people, His sons and His daughters, to be people who hear Him and understand what He wants them to be and to do. My sheep know My voice. It doesn't say my sheep wonder if I'm talking to them and they don't know if it's really me talking or not. My sheep know My voice. If there's too much distraction in your life, if there's too much noise, if you've allowed all these other things to come in and interfere with that, you need to do some house cleaning. My sheep know My voice. People with vision are the ones who are actually impacting the natural and the supernatural for the kingdom of God and accomplishing His will. And sometimes I would say most of the time, you don't know that. You're not aware of accomplishing a will. You're just doing it. You're just accomplishing the will of the Father. Why? Because you know you're doing what He wants you to do. There's no doubt in your mind. If you don't have that assurance, that's what you need to see. If you have to fast and pray, if you have to isolate yourself in a prayer closet, your prayer closet might be marked men, you know, with a little symbol on. I don't know. Wherever you need to go to get away and get all the distractions out, you need to find out, am I doing what God wants me to do, and am I allowing Him to work through me for that end? If we do not seek to see what God is seeing and what God wants to do, if we fail to have our spiritual eyes open and our spiritual ears unstopped, then we end up missing God's vision and we miss His unique purpose and work for us. And not only will we close up shop personally, even corporately, and the people all around us who do not know Jesus will perish. We have a responsibility. Where there is no vision, the people perish. So jumping to the meat of it right now, this is a big 16-ounce T-bone steak right now. We're jumping right to the meat of it. The problem with human institutions, human-founded, human-run institutions, is that they can go on for years. Now listen to me and hear me out. The problem with human-created and human-operated institutions is that they can go on for years, long after their purpose for being created has ceased to be. And in our own human strength and power, we will do whatever we can to sustain an institution well beyond its usefulness, and this does not please God. The body of Christ and the individuals who belong to it, the churches, the temples, are not supposed to be merely institutions. We get involved in all that because that's what our government tells us we have to do. We don't have to do that. We're not supposed to do that. In fact, why? Because we are meant to be, this body of people is meant to be a living organism, not an institution. An institution is what you get committed to, then they put a straitjacket on you if you don't act right. We are meant to be a living organism, vibrant. We are meant to be, that's why the scripture calls us a body. He's the head, we're the rest. We're to be the living body of Jesus Christ himself. What an exciting thing to think about. So we're not just having church. You know, we're not just going to church. We are the church. We are the body of Christ. We're the living organism, the cells and all, blood and all. We're the body of Jesus the Christ. What an exciting thought. Amen. The hands and the feet. The best example of no vision is being in a rut. And I think you all have experienced that before, you know, habitual, meaningless, stuck in the mud, not going anywhere, learned behavior, only one way to do things, boring, powerless, failing to demonstrate any vitality or any life that you have in Jesus Christ. This is the place where people perish. This is the place that's because it's a rut, and a rut is nothing more than a grave with open ends. That's all it is. That's what a rut is. So people without vision, if you don't have a vision, you're just digging your own grave and you're eventually just going to fall in it. So we've got to have a vision, a clear vision. Where there is no vision, the shepherd will perish. The people will perish. Where there is no vision, the flock will perish. As it's written in Hebrews 12, 1 and 3. 1 through 3. Therefore, since we have so great a cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let us also lay aside every encumbrance and the sin which so easily entangles us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising all the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of God, at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him who has endured such hostility by sinners against himself, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. A runner may run one race, but a long distance race is over varied terrains. I don't know, cross country especially. It's over varied surfaces. The race never changes, but the ground does. And the ground will. He has to run the entire race and have the endurance to finish it well, no matter what ground he's running on, no matter what he's running over or through. His endurance is going to be tested on the rough terrains, absolutely, but his endurance is also tested on those long, flat stretches where there's nothing interesting going on. It's all about endurance. How is that? Well, he or she does that by fixing their eyes on the finish line, on the goal, on the prize, finishing the race, not on the terrain or the surface they're on and what they have to run over, but let's do the same thing with that. Let's run this race with endurance, the race that is set before us. Let's run it with endurance, fixing our eyes on the finish. What is the finish? Our ultimate hope, life eternally within and through Jesus the Christ. If we will fix our, as Hebrews says, fix our eyes on Jesus and stop worrying about all the changing landscape, all we need to do is fix our eyes on the goal and run the race well. If we pay attention, and when I say changing landscape, you know I'm talking about a lot of things, but circumstances, mostly events in our lives, we get distracted by that and we rubberneck. And we invite other people to rubber. Take a look at this. Oh my goodness. Well, aren't you supposed to be? Yeah, but well, I'll get back there. But right now, we need to look at this. Why? I don't know. It's so gross. I just got to look at it. I don't know. And that's what we do. We rubberneck. And we get distracted and we forget we're supposed to be going this way. And we don't need to worry about all the changing landscape. All we have to do is decide that we're going to keep our eyes on the prize, Jesus. And no matter what happens, whether even if it's things we don't want or we don't expect, which is most of the time, which is usually all the time, things we don't want or we don't expect, we have to trust him anyway because he knows where the finish line is. He knows. And he's telling you to keep on running. You just listen. My sheep know my voice. If you just, he's telling you what direction to go in and to keep on running if you just do it and listen. And he provides the endurance. He provides the strength through his precious Holy Spirit to run this race well. And this is more than just a second wind. This is the wind that gets inside your spiritual lungs and you can't be stopped. You just keep running the race to the end. Vision is very personal or particular to a specific fellowship of believers. It always is. In other words, we see a lot of fellowships trying to copy other fellowships or be other fellowships. But God's designed us to do our part as who we are, not as somebody else. If we're a hand, we don't need to be acting like a foot because it doesn't work, you know? Or if we're a thumb, we don't need to be acting like a little pinky toe. That's dysfunctional. So each body of believers, each fellowship has a specific purpose and a very personal or specific vision. And of course, there are visions common to the whole church. The Great Commission is one, and there are many, many more in Scripture. Yes, we know that. But there's also a unique vision set aside for each and every body, each and every fellowship of believers. We call that a church, but it's actually a body of believers. And I know I don't need to speak this, but I'm going to speak it anyway just to remind us, because the point has to be made. We are different than a whole lot of other fellowships. And I hope you know that. We are not typical. Did you know that and they wouldn't mind me saying this, but we have people who've been coming and who plan on coming. They drive over an hour to get here. And you should hear what they say about you folks. It's so positive. I mean, it's just, it's like, who in their right mind would drive an hour here? You know? But it's because they see what we probably don't see about ourselves. We're different. We are different. We actually love on people when they come in. What is wrong with you people? I've been to, and I'm not exaggerating, I'm not blowing this up to be what it's not. People have told me, you know, I've been to 6-7 different churches, and I've had a couple people speak to me, but I came to that fellowship, those people over at Hope Light, and as soon as you said greet, I had 20 people talk to me like they've known me my whole life. Yes. And I feel so loved, unconditional. I'm accepted. And whether you know it or not, that's unique. That is unusual. It's easy to say you accept people, but it's not so easy to do it. We don't set any bars. We don't say you got to dress like me or look like me, act like. You just come as you are, whatever that is. And so we are different. We are unique. God has blessed us that way. And I'm very happy to be a part of this. But it's also one of the reasons why we don't have thousands of people here is because a lot of people don't know how to deal with reality. How do you deal with someone coming up to you and loving on you, hugging you, when you want to go to church to hide? You know, or how do you deal with standing up to sing and everybody can hear you because it's such a tight and a low ceiling and it's so intimate? I mean, I don't know if I could do that. You know, how great the Lord! You know, I don't know. But we're so we're different. We are a unique fellowship. But with that, with our makeup, with our temperaments, with our gifts, with who God has brought together here. And I've heard, I can't tell you how many, I don't know why I'm telling you these things. Well, that's up to God. I've heard, I don't know how many times, even Donald tell you, we were driving by and we were headed to XYZ church, but it's like the Holy Spirit said, no, you need to stop and go back there. That's the truth, isn't it? And we heard it again 2 weeks ago from somebody else. So God's in charge of that. You know, I'd like to get a megaphone. Don't go down there, come back in. Wouldn't go over too good in the kingdom, because that's not my jurisdiction. That's way out of my pay grade. You know, but we're unique, we're different. And I'm saying all this to get to this point, because we are different, because we are unique, this brings and puts upon us a very special responsibility too. Very, very, very special. A responsibility that calls for us to make a commitment to God's design for us. To make a 100% commitment for God's plan and act upon it. We are obligated to follow His blueprints. We really are, to take action. Vision never comes a reality, becomes a reality without action. A vision without a task is just like a grind. A vision without a task is a dream. You know, sometimes you got to wake up from the dream and do something. It's okay to dream. But you've got to put a duty to that, a task to that. A task without a vision is where you get into your grind and your rut and becomes a chore. But a vision with a task is the hope of our world. Why? Faith without works is dead. So faith with works, a vision with action, is the hope of our community. It's our hope. It gives us a purpose. God gives us a vision to guide and direct us. That's how He reveals His will and His plan. He opens our eyes. He opens our hearts and minds and shows us our true potential to bring out the best in us and to take us to new levels of life, to new levels of maturity. God-given vision allows us to see things as they, not as what they are, but what they can become and what they will be. Because if we take life for just for what it is or what we used to be, what are we doing here? You know, God allows us to see the potential and then act upon it. Our mighty, mighty God never leads us to a place where He will not provide for us. Just the children of Israel are proof of that. The size of the grapes they brought back and all. I mean, He will never lead us where He won't provide. Nothing is impossible with God. Amen. Nothing. And we're on the precipice of discovering some new adventures, I really do believe. Even with this building, we've got December 2018, our lease is up here. Well, are we going to stay? We could. We could just stay here. Or we could, you know, do this thing, that, or the other. So we're praying about that. You know, what He wants to do, Lord? We can make a decision. We can get together as the GYB Board of Elders and vote on something. But we want to do what God wants us to do. We've been presented with some options. This property over here on this side of us was up for sale. He just wants way too much for it. And so we've decided, well, let's continue praying. Let's continue seeking God. We may just stay here. We don't know. But without a vision, without looking at all the possibilities and seeking God, we're never going to know. We're just going to sit here and like, we seek the Lord. We ask God, okay, what's next, Lord? And what about our ministries, our youth ministry with Anna getting ready to, oh my goodness, she's getting married. I can't believe it. Wow. Yeah, I know. And so we're praying about that, and the possibilities have come up there. Some really good things are starting to brew with that. There's all these things happening that are a part of the vision for this corporate body. But we have to ask ourselves, then understanding with all these possibilities, then what if the vision that God gives us as a fellowship of believers is not the vision we would choose for ourselves? What do you do with that? Well, then you go right to Brother Joel Slayton, and he said this, bloom where you're planted. Whoa! No! I don't like it over there on the hillside. That's where you're planted. Bloom where you're planted. It really is that fundamentally simple. If we will do that, if we will blossom where the dirt's been dug and God has planted, where we're deposited, then our attitude will be one that lives out seeing what God wants us to see. You cannot compare the contentment, the peace that comes when you know that you are where God wants you to be and you're doing what God wants you to do. There's a peace and contentment. Scripture describes it as going beyond our understanding, a peace that passes our understanding. And if you think about your life, all the experiences you've had, those moments where you know that you're doing what you're supposed to be doing, there's a contentment you will not find in anything else. And it's a wonderful thing. We have an example that comes to mind, and I have to give you a for instance. The hummingbird and the vulture. Okay, two different types of creatures, but they both fly over our nation's deserts. That's what they do. And as they fly over the deserts, all the vulture sees when they fly in terms of sustenance is rotting meat. That's all they see and that's all they look for. That's all they hunt out is rotting meat. And you know what they find, what they're looking for. The hummingbird, on the other hand, doesn't see dead animals, and they don't look for dead animals. They look for the colorful blossoms of these desert plants, and they find them. Two creatures, one of them lives on what was, living on the past, and they fill themselves with what is dead and gone, and the other one lives on what is and seeking new life and beautiful new things. They fill themselves with freshness and being. Each bird finds what it's looking for, and so do we. That's why Scripture tells us to think on these things, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are good, whatsoever things are, fill your mind with these things, and those are the things you'll find, because that's what you're looking for. We will find what we're looking for at Hope Light, because we're going to continue to look for more of Jesus by faith. And that's how we do it. Faith is the food that visions live on. Without faith, any vision will wither on the vine, because the courage to do, the boldness to actually take action on that vision comes from our faith, believing that this is what God wants us to do. And I've got a lot of scriptures. They're in your reference, but I want to wrap it up right now, because we've come really, really far, but we've got so far to go. We're on a magnificent journey. I've seen, and so have you, seen God do so many wonderful things in the last 17, 18 years together. I mean, wonderful things. Well, he's just beginning, because he's been preparing us for what he wants to do. And we're so hard-headed, it takes 18 years to get you ready. You know, it takes that many years of school, you know? Because we never stop. Where there is no vision, The people perish. The people perish individually and corporately. So let's close with Romans 11:36. For from him and through him and to him are all things. For all things originate with him and come from him. All things live through him, and all things center in and tend to consummate and to end in him. To him be glory forever. Amen. So be it.